Everybody to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. This is the online series where we do live questions with Jochen every week. And so I'm just going to make sure that we're live on Facebook and YouTube right now. So bear with me, guys, if you are live. If you are watching live with us, please feel free to let us know or let me know where you guys are tuning in from. And please feel free to share your questions with us. We are always really eager to answer new questions live. And Jochen will be joining us in just a couple moments. I'm just gonna make sure that we are in fact live. We are live on Facebook and just checking YouTube. Perfect. So this is just a little background on Jochen for those of you who aren't familiar. So these are just a little bit of details, but every week we do an hour Q&A where we open up the floor and ask Jochen some questions to do with saddle fit or horse and rider pain, long-term damage or anything like that. So this is really just a really great hour to pick his brain and get a chance to learn from a master saddler things that we might not have known otherwise. So thank you guys for joining us, and thank you for your patience. Please feel free to comment where you're from and where you're watching, where you're tuning in from. All right, awesome. Let's move on with the intro sequence and welcome Jochen into the stream. Welcome, Jochen.
How are you?
Great, how are you?
Good. I don't know if you can hear the background noise, but we have some well, construction worker next door, and they like to play the music very loud. So you have a little bit. It's not bad.
No, I can't hear anything, so it's all good. I'm pretty sure we're okay. But if we do, then I'm sure our audience members will probably forgive us for that. Awesome.
Super. What are we talking about this week?
So this week we have a really awesome question we're going to be starting off with that has to do with biomechanics of horse and rider. And that will probably take up a good portion of today's discussion. But of course, the floor is always open for new questions if they roll in. And we also have a lot of leftover questions from Instagram and Facebook that we'll get to later on in the episode. But Jochen, if you'd like to kick us off with that, I can ask the full question if you'd like.
I have a question for you. The biomechanics, this question is going to be a little longer, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to, before we get into it, maybe say why I'm going to answer the way the question comes. So should I go and do a little intro or not this time?
Sure, that sounds good. Sure. Yeah, for those who may not be familiar, that makes sense, I think.
Okay, so this was my favorite horse. This horse was not my first horse. My horse, what I trained all the way to 4-star 3-day eventing, who jumped very high fences with me and took me to the German team, and we tried very hard to qualify for the 84 Olympics. I'm not saying that to impress you, I'm just saying to you that as a saddle maker, I had everything to my hands to make sure I had the best saddle, the best reins, and et cetera. But yet it ended his career because of the equipment failure. Now you might say, what a shoddy or what a bad saddle maker that is, cripple his own horse. So let me tell you a little bit about saddle making and saddleries. Different countries, different rules. I grew up in Germany, first in Buenos Aires, but where I did my apprenticeship was in Germany, 3 years apprenticeship. I learned pretty much everything what you can possibly think, if it's the splint boots, breastplates, bridles, saddles. And then after the 3 years, I went to a journeyman where I worked for many different companies to learn how to make saddles. Great effort is placed on doing nice craftsmanship, fine design, picking the best leather and knowing all the different metals, materials, etc. But not a single company I worked all over in England as well as in Germany. I should rephrase that. It wasn't all over in England. It was in Warsaw, which is the capital saddle making in England. And so I saw a lot of saddleries there, but never where I worked did anybody really talked about saddle fitting. Funny enough, it is the most perception from people when they think, oh, you're a saddle maker, you know how to fit a saddle? Saddle makers have absolutely no clue, because the majority are not a horseback rider, the majority of the saddle makers. I remember in my class from 30, there were only two, a woman and myself, who were riders. And it's not trained saddle thing. It's a different school. And that's where another huge problem comes, because there's 6 different philosophy how saddle is fitted. So there's so many opinions how a saddle should fit. And while I made a nice saddle, what I liked very much, and I thought fit my horse very well, and I could jump very high fences with it. When it comes to fitting of the saddle, all we really knew is, oh, shouldn't hit the withers, should have nice balance. But little did I know that there is a long-term damage you can create by saddles. So everything I answered and everything I'm discussed going forward is based on scientific facts. I made myself a promise that I will search around the world for the best science in the field and ask them any questions what possibly can come to my mind as a trainer, as a rider, as a judge, as a saddle maker, as a saddle fitter, to really, really understand the physiology, the biomechanics, the anatomy of the horse, not necessary to become a veterinarian, but when it comes to movement, when it comes to where should the saddle sit and for sure where the saddle shouldn't sit. So these 3 people here, in my opinion, are the pinnacle of the saddle fitting research professors in Vienna, Germany, as well as in Zurich. They have all kinds of tools and modern technology, what blew my mind, from fiber optic cameras to thermography to computerized saddle pack, gait analysis, heart monitor. I mean, it's insane how much detail we can now, we as equine professionals, or I should say they as veterinarians, can look into the horse without waiting the horse's damage for life. So this is what I strive my entire life. I'm approaching 60 and I promised myself in the early 20s, I will share what I learned over all these years from all around the world. It doesn't matter if they come from South America. Very pleased to say the saddle fit philosophy. It's where we make saddles on. This is a way of fitting saddles to rider and to horse. And saddle fit for life means nothing else than following the anatomy of the horse and respect the anatomy of the rider and how both beings, the horse and the rider, work together. And hopefully the interface does not cripple one or the other. And it's interesting to see that top riders who also are veterinarians, who have learned to become a rider, say, hey, look on top. This guy is pointing on top. Many riders crank and pull. Now, do they do this on purpose because they're mean riders or because they're simple in the wrong gender appropriate saddle and they're sitting in the wrong saddle? Now, when I say that, it says, what is a wrong saddle? Well, it starts off by, well, if you ask, who do you want to ask? You ask a saddle fitter, a saddle maker, or should we ask a medical doctor? Okay? A medical doctor who say there is massive difference between the female and the male pelvis. And if the saddle is not built correctly to the gender appropriate person, then you will cripple the rider. But the horse in the end pays the price. So we have the interface between the pelvis, skeleton of the rider. We have the movement of the horse, the skeleton of the horse. And of course, we have, as I said, veterinarians who now say, if you ride wrong, the back, right? Also training, you know, if it's either bad saddle, because you have not a female saddle, because you're a female, you ride in a male saddle, or you're male and you ride it in the female saddle and you don't even know, you know, because your saddle fitter or salesperson never give you the chance to try both genders. So even though you're a girl, I will definitely recommend try both saddles. The same model, same company, try the male and the female version. The difference is day and night. And it's not just for you, for the horse, because the horse will not cramp and get tight on the neck like you see here on this horse, okay? Tight, tight, tight. Bracing in the base of the withers and then curling behind the vertical. And then of course, the lumbar sacral joint is a gotta go, right? So if we understand, okay, and we want to learn to people who studied and flown around the world, just like me, veterinarians to really can go to the detail, right? Then I, as a manufacturer, or as a saddle ergonomist, or a person who rides, loves horses, should never, ever, ever question people who understand how these animals work. So Schlaeser, the company who I make saddles with, follows the Saddle Fit for Life philosophy, which is making saddles and for rider and horses. And horses will tell you, this lady here wrote an article about the horse's pain. Okay, so they talk. Horses don't lie. Look at their eyes, their face, right? So we know horses can communicate not with English or German or Portuguese. They have, but we also have body language. And when you approach a horse with your saddle and the horse has wide eyes, ears come back, ask your question. Is that really my horse or is he just telling me something? So if you don't want to use whips and spurs, and if you don't want to fall in the trap of opinion, then I should say beg you for the sake of the horses, follow the common sense, listen to body workers, physiotherapists, veterinarians, and of course, think about it. Would you as a guy ride in female underwear? Would you as a guy ride in female jeans? Never. Why would you ladies ride in the male saddle? Right, so we have saddles for war, we have saddles for work, and we have saddles for sport. One of the key problems we face today is that the modern horse gets bred more sensitive. In other words, they're a little bit more electric. That's what the high sport demands. Also, we have a massive problem that the modern horse from today are an upright rectangle. What's the problem with that? Okay, the old horses were a flat rectangle, broad chest, not so long legs, and for saddle makers, and for the sake of the life of the horse, and so the horse can move nicely, we have a nice, strong back. Today, we want the horses very electric, we want the horse's legs to swing further forward, never mind the hind leg, but we focus apparently only on the front. And in the saddle world, we have a new dilemma. We have the area where the saddle sits much, much shorter, so that 8 out of 9 saddles, like this one, sits in the rear of the saddle. And it's incredible how many people do not know that. This is so, you're looking from the back, the lumbar sacral is so flimsy. It is so thin. Just to reinsure, I can't show this enough. Here you see that first lumbar. Look how thin that bone is. Here's the pen. The pen, you see how thick the pen is. So you can see how thin this is. And it's very, very fragile. Now you say, oh, my horse has a lot of muscles there. He will not hurt. And I'm a very light rider. And it's just a little bit too long. There's no such a thing as a little bit too long because it's the same thing. If you're a father or a man and your girlfriend or daughter comes home and says, oh, daddy, or hey, honey, don't worry, I'm just a little bit pregnant. You would freak out. Are you or you're not? In the same with saddles. There's no such a thing as little bit. Either the saddle is in the dark zone and hits these phones or not. Many people have no clue. The horse will deviate from it, will hollow. The biomechanics, I'm going to show you a couple of videos, will clearly indicate that the horse will go away. But will also go away all the space. This is the spine, the top of the spine is all grown together. It's kissing spine or overriding dorsal processes. Okay, the horse is a survival animal and will protect itself and deviates from pain when the saddle is too long, either in the front or in the back. Right? Most of the time it's in the back. You're looking from the back and you see the massive pressure there. And in motion, when the horse moves, okay, it will drive the saddle onto the shoulder. And when it drives onto the shoulder, you see massive dry spots. And on top of the shoulder, there's cartilage. You see the damage on the cartilage. And it's shown in so many pictures and in so many videos. And it's really sad to say that to this day, people think that the saddle should fit like a bridge. Call it the bridge fit. You dig here and dig here. You see in the middle here, it's hollow. So when the back comes up, then it will have nice even contact. But everything what goes up goes down. In other words, when we talk about biomechanics or movement of the horse, everybody wants to ride a horse which moves up and down and swings nice. In canter, you have this kind of a motion. The horse will not swing if you dig into the most sensitive area in the lumbar or in the front, or systematically cripple the horse's scapula. Here you see the tree digging into the shoulder. This is a horse laying on his right side, the left side. This is doing a dissection. The veterinarian shows the students. Here is a classic tree, wooden tree with two short tree points, the metal sticking out. Here you see the D-ring where you put your breastplate. So if you ever want to know how to measure the width of the tree, okay, you would measure it from D-ring to D-ring. You'd be surprised how many saddles are way too narrow there. If you want to know the angle, you would measure the angle from the D-ring to the point of that metal that allows that shoulder to come through. Underneath the fascia here and underneath these muscles is the bone, and this here is the cartilage. This is the shoulder blade. You can see how it's been damaged from the saddle. So I cannot emphasize enough that if you want to have horses to move nice and free, oh, we got here going on, okay, then the horse needs to bring the back up, okay? It needs to come up so they don't touch. So we're gonna talk about today about biomechanics. I don't think I can play this video. Let me see if I can trick it. Yay. So let's try that again. Here you go. I want you to see how much these muscles contract and elongate. And I play that quite often, this video. And for you who visit us regularly each Thursday, thank you very much. Good to see you. But I know we also always have new people. And that's why I'm showing this all the time, because you want to see that this movement here in slow motion, you can see how the shoulder comes upwards, backwards. And when we talk about shoulder freedom, that means that the tree cannot be too long, because a saddle that's too long in the back gets pushed in motion forward. The scapula can rotate 6 to 8 inches backwards, okay? So there's an old myth, especially in the English saddle fitting school, they say put the saddle tree 2 inches back because the shoulder goes back 2 inches, minimum 4, okay? So if you put your saddle 4 inches back, now what? You're sitting on the croup. Okay, so in order for the saddle to fit, you need the right width. So when the leg strides forward, that scapula can slide underneath without crippling the cartilage like you see here. So when I talk about biomechanics, okay, I never want to see a horse what trots like this, because this is, you're too late. Okay, here you see the neck is fused, the back is fused, there's no more movement, this horse is typical for Arabs, they have high pain threshold. And that horse has no neck, no back muscle. And yes, you could do spinal surgery, but very often when they do spinal surgery, they do it on top and they can't go all the way down underneath where they're all grown together. So before it goes to this stage where all this calcifies, it calcifies down here as well. Okay? And look how little that hole is versus that hole. This is normal. See these holes here, that's where the nerves come out, the spinal nerves. And if you ever know anybody or you ever had a pinched nerve in your back, game over. I mean, that is so painful. So horses will not say, ow, 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 okay? They will just guard themselves. And we can see in the movement problems. So as I said, we can cut through the top and cut the top of the spinal processes, but the bottom ones, you can't fix. So very often, this is just a nuisance from misinformation. And that's why, Mary Claire, you and I do what we do, correct? We want to make sure that people don't lose the horses because of some people's opinion.
Exactly. And out of ignorance, people don't know what they don't know, right?
Yeah, 100%. So do you want to start out with the first question?
Sounds great. Awesome introduction, Jochen, by the way. That was a really great one. It's like you get better every week. Okay, so let's start off with this and tackle this biomechanics question. So this full question is, what are horse and rider biomechanics and how does it relate to saddle fit?
Okay. Can I ask you a question? Mm-hmm. When you walk, do you swing in your arms when you walk?
Occasionally, yeah. My whole body moves.
Yeah.
It's like a chain reaction. Yeah.
And when you walk, what arm goes forward and what leg goes forward? So let's say you move your right arm forward when you walk, what leg goes forward?
Is it the right one? Yeah, the right one goes forward with it.
Okay, so if you walk with your right arm and your right leg forward, go ahead and do this right now.
Okay.
We don't see it. We don't watch. Just tell me how that feels.
Oh, yeah, that's awkward.
That's awkward.
Yeah, it's the opposite. It's the opposite.
You know who walks like this? Camels. Okay?
Camels so, walk right. Like oh, okay.
We call that in horse language pacing. Right, so when the same leg in the hind and the same leg on the front go forward. So in when you walk with your right arm forward, left leg forward, that's a diagonal movement. And horses move just like humans. And that whole body movement you were saying, right, your spine twist where you walk, what it actually does, and this is how we learn as babies, it signals through the nerve, through the spine, oh, I walk. So when you ever seen for the first time, a person was paralyzed from the waist down and she is for the first time on the horse. You know why they cry?
Because they feel that movement again.
Yes. They feel that movement and the diagonal mechanic movement of the horse. Okay. They think they are walking actually. They think I'm not paralyzed anymore. Okay. So the diagonal movement of the horse matches what we know since we are babies when we learned, oh, we don't need to crawl. We can actually walk on two legs. So your question is, how does that connect with the saddle? The saddle has to adapt to the diagonal movements. Now, as a saddle maker, I can use plastic trees. They're super cheap. The second cheapest saddle on the market, the trees are wood trees. They're very cheap, but they do not allow the diagonal movement. Unless you're over 200 pounds, okay? Then they have a little spring. They call them wood spring trees, okay? But the best trees on the market, that's why we patent them, is the adapt tree. The tree will adapt to the spinal moves of the rider and of the horse. So, when you ride dressage, or when you walk and somebody says to you, you know, you should have a back brace so your back doesn't move, what's your first thought when you hear that?
a back brace so your back doesn't move.
Yeah.
It's inhibiting your ability to walk.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So in the Western world, we have now Western dressage and we have cowboy dressage. And one of the incredible top veterinarian in the world wrote several books, a very good writer, as well as one of the top veterinarians. He wrote Tuck and War and The Balance. And he says, Western horses can never do cowboy dressage if you have a saddle what is rigid. Okay, so where mm-hmm. wood tree is rigid. So if you have a Western saddle, what is made out of wood, it's rigid. It's like if you have a back brace. And movement in dressage is that the back swings left to right. So he endorses saddles where the tree adapts with the movement. Does that make sense?
Definitely.
So when I have a horse what needs to pull a cow out of the ditch and I need to put a rope on it, then I need a saddle what has an absolutely rigid tree. Right, that makes sense to me. So, okay, that's what I'm going to...
No, so you need something that can adapt to the movement of the body. Yeah, you need something that isn't rigid.
100%. Mm-hmm. If I look at the top here, this spine, this whole spine, like on humans, will move left to right. Mm-hmm. Now, what we also have to consider, we have the same diagonal movement of the horse, walk, trot. Canter is a little bit different. Canter is like walk is this. Trot is this, but canter is kind of like a caterpillar, okay? And we have movement which goes up and down. Now, how would you compare that when you have to jump up and down? How would that work for your body if you jump up and down? Where would you absorb that?
In your feet, probably, or in your legs and your feet.
Right? Ankle, knees, mm-hmm. and hips. So let's say without the horse, the rider were to jump. So jumps with both legs forward. I guarantee you, he will not keep his knees straight at landing.
Mm-hmm,
because
mm-hmm.
he's going to break his back or pop his kneecap.
Right.
So he or she will land with the knees bent. So when a good rider has a very relaxed hip and a good knee and a good ankle, okay, these are your shock absorption. Now in riding, when you ask me the question, how does the biomechanics of the horse and rider work together? When the neck, the back, the lower back and the tailbone is four curves. Now your spine, okay, is built so when you run, you walk, this spine holds you upright and this spine is also a shock absorption. So can you imagine if you ride like that, okay, there's no more shock absorption, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you're now gripping with your knee because otherwise your leg is going to kick this horse in the nose.
So your dead weight.
Yeah.
Your dead weight on the horse. Yeah.
Absolutely. Right. And you have no more the natural curves. You have that chicken neck and you're mm-hmm. pounding that horse in the back. So what I'm always looking for when I'm looking at riders is the saddle allowing the rider sitting over the sternum, over the horses with the sternum. So now you're in the balance point. If you ever rode a horse bareback or you ever rode a horse what bucks or ever jumped a horse, there's a sweet spot where you can really use the least amount of bouncing. So if I'm thinking about this as my mini saddle, how do you like that? Is it cute?
Oh, that's so cute.
So if I sit too far back, that's where it's bouncing and I bounce. If I sit right close in the center, okay, and have a woman's saddle with a cutout in the front, if I'm a woman, okay, and the horse does all this bucking, all this movement underneath me in the center here. That's the least amount of movement. If you sit too far back, bounce, bounce. So what you want to do, like I said before, have your four curves as your shock absorption, have a relaxed knee, hip, and ankle as your shock absorption. But then the most important part, align sternum to sternum. Okay, so now if you ride a big trot, a big canter, there's a lot of upwards and downwards motion, right? So look at this video here. So what did you notice first, Mary Claire?
I was muted. Sorry. I felt like the rider looked like he was leaning back a little bit at first, the beginning of that video.
Yeah, but when it comes to movement, mm-hmm. like, and did you see a lot of up and down there?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when I look at the this movement here, all right, mm-hmm. I always look for short apes and heels.
Right.
That to be the highest. This should never be behind the vertical. That hind leg should step nicely under, but most important, I want that back here nicely underneath. But look again when you watch when how much the jacket in the back sinks. Look at that. See how that jacket goes up and down?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right? So that I need to sit. I need to sit that kind of a movement, and I can only sit that kind of a movement when I have my sternum over the horse's sternum. Otherwise, I bounce a lot up and down.
Right.
Are you with me so far?
Yeah.
I want to see if I can make that a little bit bigger because I just noticed that's a lot of space there. Okay. All right, so now let's have another video quick look and have a look at this here. And then I'm going to talk to you about let me see. So you cannot see the whole picture, but if I stop this, I can see this is going down. Look how far forward the rider leans.
Mm-hmm.
So the rider tries to get off the horse's saddle, and if we know how we run or walk as humans, you would never do that as much as you see here, correct?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So obviously her sternum is way ahead of the horse's sternum and way ahead of the ball of the foot. So that is totally against the normal biomechanics of a human.
Mm-hmm.
Now the saddle, however, places her like that,
mm-hmm.
and she has no chance. So she has to now ride completely unnatural. That throws the horse completely out of balance. This horse, watch what he does with the head and with the whole movement. She's constantly, see how he came up there?
Mm-hmm.
So brakes on C3, so that's right there. He's braking at the neck. He's refusing to go forward. Now she's poking him in the side. Okay, and she tries to sit light, but that poor woman, who I happen to know is a very good rider, but she has this saddle what does not allow her to stay out of the horse's way. So you can
right.
see the motion, how the horse is fighting, and that doesn't look normal, does it?
Definitely not. Yeah, well, you could definitely see how the saddle's putting her in a really bad position.
Even this direction, the horse, she leans so far forward, the horse says, what are you doing up there? So Zach, see how he comes up there?
Mm-hmm.
Right, so the poor rider has no chance to sit like this because she says, if I sit back there, he's bucking. So I ask her, why do you sit so far back? Okay, if I sit back, then look what the horse is doing. Watch the hind leg. So it stops, and she puts the leg on. Horse doesn't know where to go. She leans back, and when she leans back, he does this.
Wow, okay? Yeah.
So the only way that chance, she has a chance to get that horse forward if she leans forward.
Wow.
All right. So mm-hmm. that's a gorgeous horse, what has absolutely no chance to really go well if you sit in a saddle, what puts the horse in the wrong frame. So B is in the wrong frame. When the saddle hurts the horse in the shoulders or digs in the loin, they go hollow. And the only way for the horse to go against it is, well, either tighten up or they get these divots in the back. Okay? Mm-hmm. See how the rider sits like this?
Right.
Okay? So she sits like this, and the other lady in the video sits like this too because she was riding also in the male saddle. A male saddle with the male pelvis here, sits on the seat bone, and you see that little space. I'm going to make that bigger so everybody can see that better. See how there's a gap in front of the, you don't see that here, right? So if the female rides on the male saddle, the seat bones are in the air and she gets slammed in the crotch, right? So what should you do? You lean back, you put your seat back. But when you sit, you put these divots in the horse. So the poor lady has never ever a chance if you're sitting on the wrong balance point. So if we look at the difference between male and female, okay, you need to keep, because let's say you have children and you have a little boy and a little girl, both of those will walk on the ball of the foot when they're young, and both of them will learn how to walk on two legs. The only difference, if your daughter and your son will ride, the boy has a longer tailbone and has more security and more balance with the butt cheeks because the lower back is straighter. Doesn't matter if he's fully grown or he's a boy. He's a boy. He has a long tailbone, no pelvis, and no birth pelvis. A birth pelvis, a girl, has more arc and the butt cheek is lower. She has less support here. Yeah? The first word hits is the crotch. So if I ignore that on the lady, these bones come lower than on the male, you can have a beautiful horse, beautiful movement. And how many times have we watched this video? You know what video is coming, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. So here you see a horse. Okay. Even more so, you see how the rider leans back?
Right.
Okay. Not over the ball of the foot, not in alignment, not over the center of gravity. The horse trots out of the elbow. Now, just by sitting half your weight, and this is a light lady, right? Now she sits upright, the back comes up behind the saddle, right? And look how the horse trots in the front. So if you sit and look side by side, trotting out of the elbow, lady sits back on the left, and just poetry and motion on the right. Absolutely gorgeous, right? So if you want to do biomechanics, I beg you, don't listen to me, listen to doctors, okay? Where they clearly see if you don't ride in the right gender appropriate style, you just hurt your horse, okay? It doesn't matter if you get instructors what will charge you an arm and a leg and give you tons of lessons. Your body cannot deform, reinforce wood trees with steel or any kind of a tree or leather or foam. Your body will fall in that chair seat, okay? So if you want to sit on these, as I said earlier, these new hypersensitive horses, and you're not sitting half your weight, you're pounding in the horse's back, what's already too short, you've got to sit forward without, sorry to be so rude, crushing your crotch, and the horse will be owie, right? So my recommendation, if you look at biomechanics and you're asking me how should that work, how should that be together, it can look beautiful, or it could look like this, where you adjust. This is another picture. Okay, the horse wants to go, and every time she sits back or leans forward, the horse tries to help the rider to be in the balance point. But as soon as the rider comes in the balance point, the horse is just not happy, and it hops. Get off my lumber. Right? So they hate that. Now, of course I can smack the horse. Of course I can use a whip, or I can just maybe investigate a little bit and says, maybe it's not so good to sit on the back bones of the horse. If you want biomechanics, follow the rule of what we call the circle of influence. If you have a good trainer, good nutrition, veterinarian, you have a good saddle, and you watch your horse on the launch line, walk, trot, canter, it's very easy. Take your phone out and videotape that. Preferably not on the side rein, on the bridle. Don't tie the head. And videotape the horse's back. How does this back swing? You get a good idea in walk and trot and canter. Then what every instructor will ask you, when you sit on this horse, should you A, make this movement worse, better, or the same? 100% better, not the same. Because the same means he now carries you, and the back will hollow because gravity rules, okay? And when you don't bring the back up, you will have kissing spines. So my recommendation is, if you understand and you saw it on video, how your horse's back swing, have somebody else videotape yourself. If you have a horse what has beautiful cadence, nice movement, soft through the pole, he chews, he has foam, he breaks, not over the middle of the neck, he's soft in his hand. Now you have two diagonal spines. Right? Remember we talked about right leg goes forward, then your left arm goes forward. That's how you walk diagonal. So when you have that motion, that movement in the spine, Western or English, and you sit over the right spot, you ride half your weight, and the horse's spine and the rider's spine melt into one. Then you got poetry in motion.
Excellent, thanks, Jochen. And the only other thing I was gonna mention is that if you are going to film yourself and are concerned about your saddle fit, do not forget that we offer free online saddle fit assessments with saddle fit experts. So if you're having trouble really watching your footage and really knowing, understanding what's happening, we have experts at your disposal who are happy to discuss that with you and review that with you. So don't hesitate to check that out. And I'm going to post that link in both chat boxes right now.
And is that for every saddle?
For every saddle, for any discipline, we are here to help assist you guys and to give some advice, saddle fitting advice. And all of that can be done online through phone call or through email. So there's no reason why COVID is holding anybody back. We can do everything from the comfort of our homes these days. So it's all possible.
What else do they get? Are we still offering any kind of rewards for sharing and stuff like that?
Oh yeah, we still have our giveaway that we're currently running.
Until December, right?
Sorry?
Until December.
Yeah, that's December 31st. Until the very end of the year, we are running a saddle giveaway. So you can enter to win. If you're watching right now, I'm going to be posting the link. Well, it's just the link to our website, schleza.com or saddlesforwomen.com. And it'll be the first photo that you see on there. We'll take you to our giveaway. And all you have to do is follow us on our socials and you'll get a chance to win. And it's a beautiful saddle of your choice. Actually, it's a saddle of your choice. So any discipline, you could win. So up to $9,000. So that's just an unbelievable opportunity, guys. So check that out. And also for those of you who've already submitted, if you were to refer extra friends, you get extra additional entries into the giveaway as well, which is something that I feel like people often forget. Jochen, we're already almost out of time this week. Oh, it's crazy, but that was such a great way to spend the hour. We have a couple more questions that have come in live from people watching right now that I think would be great to get to.
Okay.
So this is from Peyton, or Paint Pot, sorry. Hi Jochen, could you please explain how the mane indicates how the girth should be girthed? He touched on this a few weeks ago and I was wondering if he could explain it a little more, please and thanks.
Okay, so as we know, horses do not have a collarbone. The front legs of the horse are attached to the rib cage by several muscles. The two main muscles are the pectoralis and the serratus, shoulder muscle and the chest muscle. And like humans, horses are favoring one side, left hand or right hand. Now, we have now over 160,000 horses measured. And we also have people who have dissected many, many horses like this lady. And it's really interesting when she knows pretty much all the history of the horses. She only dissects horses when she gets to see the saddles they had, the history of saddle fitting, the type of riding, or if it's a carriage horse. And the upper arm, the deformity in the upper arm is unbelievable. And that is something I hear always, over and over again. And the first time I heard that was from Tony Gonzalez. Tony Gonzalez was a fifth generation Ferrier from Hawaii. He wrote the book, Proper Movement and Balance. In his book, he has this page. You can see here the rib cage. This pink thing is the serratus. Of course, it's way more strings there. And I don't have drawing in here the pectoralis. The muscle comes from the upper arm. So 1 out of 10 horses look like this. And I look at the bigger side here. There's definitely a higher side and a lower side. So this higher side will push the main comb into the hollow side. Now it could be only muscles unevenness, or look at the upper arm here compared to this. Okay, so all this dissection and all this research, we can see, unfortunately we can't, I shouldn't say we, I'm not a vet, but veterinarians or universities, they cannot x-ray a horse between the chest. They can't slide a plate in here, and they can't put the horse into an MRI, the whole body. There is not enough big enough machine. They can put the whole neck in it, the whole leg, but they cannot put the whole horse in an MRI. So unfortunately, if your horse is crooked like this one here, you clearly see much bigger shoulder. And then again, like I showed you in the drawing, the bigger one pushes that mane over to that side. So the weaker side, the less developed shoulder, okay, is always smaller and it's more forward. Think about yourself. If you make your shoulders forward, most of the time you see it on people who don't have a lot of shoulder muscles. People who work out or have a good posture or have a lot of shoulder muscles, the shoulder goes wider and back. So the shoulder, what is bigger and wider, it's further back. The weaker one is further forward. So if I simulate that with my shoulder, would be like this. This is smaller, further forward. This is wider, further back. So if you were to go on my back and look at the scapular, you clearly can feel one side is more forward like this one. Now, if you put the saddle on, what also happens, remember what I said, the horses has not a collarbone. So I'm going to show you this front leg here. Let's take that off, easier to show. So here's a little pony leg. Put that together. This pony leg flew around the world with me several times. I wonder if I can go to another better camera. Let me just switch that and I go to this camera. Okay. I'm gonna move the saddle to the side. So here you can see where the leg is. This is the upper arm. This is the shoulder. And where my thumb is the elbow. So when that leg goes forward, it pushes this upper arm forward and that scapula rotates upwards, backwards. So that's the motion. Now, from this inside of the shoulder blade, okay, so the inside of this shoulder blade right there, from here and from here, there's muscles where the trunk hangs literally from the front leg. And if one is less developed, it's more forward. If it's wider and it's more upright. Now, also what is different is the elbow. Okay, so remember, this is not connected with the collarbone on humans. So this front leg here, you will see the horse with the bigger shoulder has that elbow further back. The horse with the smaller shoulder has the elbow on the other side more forward. So how can we test that? You can put the horse square. Okay, so you can put the horse square, have a friend use the whip, hold the whip where the girth would go. And while the customer, your friend holds the horse, you measure the distance from elbow to whip on that side. When you walk around, make sure that whip doesn't go diagonal like that or like that. You want that whip let's say it's a whip, to the right angle to the spine. Okay, it takes you 2-3 times and then you get it. And I guarantee you the distance here, it's smaller if the horse is bigger on the left side, which most horses are. Okay, this horse doesn't stand 100% and I took the bone out, but if you would go walk around the horse, you will see more space here. So the girth will always follow to the front, because you can see how the rib cage goes narrow to the front. Okay, so it goes narrow. So that's gravity. Every girth will go to the narrow spot. And if one side is more forward on the right, it will go more forward on the right. That will then take your saddle and twist your saddle to the right. Okay, so what you need to do, you take your first two billets on the right side where the shoulder is less, and on the left side where that is elbows further back, use the back two billets. Okay, so the girth will hold the saddle from pushing and hitting against this lumbar area. Okay, so to summarize it, whatever side the mane goes, you use the first and the second billet. If the mane parts left and right, absolutely even front to back, first and third, first and third. If the mane goes in the back on the withers to the left, on the front to the right, most likely you need to see your veterinarian, chiropractor, osteopath. They're probably disaligned here, okay? And that needs to be fixed to the neck. But for me, whatever is dictated in the wither area through the shoulder is where I decide what billets I use.
Excellent. Thanks, Jochen. That was a really great explanation, really comprehensive. I'll probably cut that one up too and make that another video as well. Thank you for your question. I think it was Peyton or Paint Pot. I hope that answers your question if you're still with us. And we only have a couple minutes left, but if you guys would like to ask any more questions, we will definitely be saving that for next week and we'll come back and answer as many as we can. Jochen, would you like me to ask another quick question, or is there anything you'd like to discuss?
Well, maybe we can quick discuss this here. We just talked about the uneven shoulder. Mm-hmm. So here again, it's the rib cage, the serratus and the pectoralis. And when you ride, these muscles gets wider, the shoulders gets wider and the rib cage will lift. If you don't ride, the muscle disappear and it goes back the way it was. Muscle atrophy 4 times faster than they appear, and body fat appears 4 times faster than it comes, then it disappears. So when I'm fitting saddles and I have a horse, like I just showed you, okay, and veterinarians who are writing books and have studied horses over and over and says, you know, sometimes horses are not just muscular different, they're actually quite a bit different in the bone structure, like I showed you in the picture from the book from Tony Gonzalez. Now, let me show you a little bit better drawing here, because this is really how these muscles hang. Here's again the rib cage. Here's the serratus. Here's the pectoralis. So the upper arm, the muscles from the upper arm to the rib cage, and here, the shoulder blade, the serratus to the rib cage. When the horse gets wider, it lifts the trunk. See how this came up? So a horse, what is not ridden, horses are by nature on the forehand, means they have more weight on the front two legs than the back two legs, and they have easy access to the grass, what they eat 17 hours out of the day in the wild. And if you look at the first type of horses, they're called eohippus. Their croup was extremely high and the front legs were really, really small. So when we ride and train the horse, these muscles get wider, the shoulder, the breast, the chest, everything gets wider. And that lifts the trunk, kind of like me If I stand up, I grow. That has nothing to do with my age. It has something to do with my posture. Now, some people claim through lunging, through proper type of lunging the horse in tight circles, you get the horse to make straight. No, you cannot make that bone straight. Okay, so that is a complete false statement. What you could do, if it's a muscular, it says a muscular thing. There is, you can do a lot from the ground, long reining, riding, or lunging. Then you can help the horse a lot. But to claim that you can make everybody straight with lunging is a complete myth. And if people say, oh my God, if you girth the girth uneven, then the girth is uneven. The girth will be uneven no matter what, because the girth will follow gravity. Okay? You have the choice. Do you want to ride on the saddle what is twisted and put a lot of pressure on the horse? Or do you want to have a saddle what stays straight and only the girth stays twisted? So from all these false myths and from all these stories, it is really sad to say it non-least, that the horse always pays the price. And if I can recommend one thing, ask the question why. Remember, the person knows the how will always follow the person knows the why. Ask questions. Don't tell people, oh, because I say so. You want to understand why the horse is so atrophy. When you see these pain lines here, some veterinarians write a book and call that pain line. Some people, oh, no, that's just a fly shaker muscle. Oh, no, that's just a fit line. That's something what we talk sweet. You know, so that is the picture of the cranial nerve 11, the CN11, okay, that feeds into the wither in the cup area. So if the saddle pinches there, you see a lot of them have super, super tight shoulders, and that drives that rib cage down. So who cares if you are a good lunging expert or good long lining? If your saddle pinches there, your horse would never go straight. Okay, straightness has a lot of factors. One, of course, is you. Many people don't switch the stirrup leathers. You create an uneven horse because your stirrup leathers switch. Your stirrup leather needs to be switched every 3 weeks. People don't do that because they don't know. It's a long strap that can stretch. If you have the double ones with nylons, they don't stretch as much, but check them at least once a month. Okay? Then you could be crooked. Okay? We are not machines. We can be uneven. But my biggest pet peeve is there that people think the saddle is the magic pill and one fits all. The majority of the horses are not even. They have, just like us, the appendix on the right side. No world champion, no industry ever launches the horse to the right. They only launch to the left in the vaulting. That's gymnastic on horses. Majority horses race to the left. Okay, they all go to the left. Horses like to be bowing out when they digest the food. They like you on the left. When you talk to people who live with horses in the wild, they will say, yeah, when horses fight, they always fight with the left side. They guard the right side. Go ahead and lead your horse after you fed him. See how much he likes you on that side. So if we learn from our ancestors, if we learn from our experts, true horse people, okay, then I really, really say today, if you don't have a great-great-grandfather who's still alive, right, who had horses when saddles were fitted for, well, for function, not for opinions or passion, then listen to the experts. You know, don't wait until your horse is crippled because of ego like mine, where I just thought I'm the world's best riders and I know what to do. Yeah, great. Cost me my horse's life. So I won't make that mistake. I beg all of you, listen to the experts. Who are the experts? Those are veterinarians who understand biomechanics, movement of the horse. Don't put saddles on the shoulders. Observe how you sit, if you sit in the gender appropriate saddle. And if you don't remember anything, remember this. Never ride in the saddle what is not made for the proper gender. Other than that, you will never have a happy horse.
Thank you, Jochen. And I just want to say before we log off, today. Thank you to everybody who's joining us. We're getting a lot more questions for next week. Hopefully we have a lot of material. And I just want to say thank you, everybody, for all of your kind comments. There are a lot of people saying, thank you, Jochen, for sharing your knowledge. It's completely super invaluable and super brilliant. So thank you guys for tuning in. And again, thank you, Jochen, for spending this time with us. We really, really appreciate getting to pick your brain and learn more and more every week. So thank you for the special hour, and we'll see you next week.
Okay.